Happy October.
October.
I don't know what day in October, but I think this comes out in October. I mean, we're in September. It's not like we're far away from October right now, but I think this is broaching into Halloween season, this episode.
That makes sense to me.
I'm glad, because I don't know that it makes sense to myself.
I think I'm on my way to understanding
this. Excellent.
That is what I used to say all the time in high school.
I think I am on my way. That's actually a really diplomatic way of being like, there. What are you talking about?
I'm on my way to greater understanding.
To your level of...
Have I crossed the finish line? Absolutely not.
I don't know. I don't think I'm at... I think I accidentally created a bootleg finish line.
Wait a minute.
Somewhere far away and you got off course. And now we're just kind of in the woods.
Yeah. I was by finish line, I mean the one that we created in like an industrial
park.
We
just drew it
far away from the marathon.
With chalk and got lost. Anyway, welcome to our show. It's called And That's Why We Drink. It's about ghosts and murder.
Oh.
And all our inadequacies.
Oh. So speaking of inadequacies, I have two things I would like to say, both about my own inadequacies.
Congratulations.
Okay. One, I decided that I was also going to do the Myers-Briggs test again because I haven't done it in a while.
Yeah.
And if you listen to one of our last episodes.
It was, I think the last one.
You said you were INFP turbulent.
T. Yeah.
I did it because I'm always kind of like on the fence. I'm like apparently a perfect ambivert. And so every time I do the test, I'm either INFP or ENFP.
It depends on like your week that week.
Yeah. Yeah. Today I'm ENFP.
Okay.
Turbulent.
Turbulent. No way. I like how I'm so shocked. Also, are you calling me inadequate?
No, I'm calling myself inadequate. Well, maybe both of us
at
the same time.
I think you just took me with you on that ride.
I never knew turbulent was like part of the deal here, but apparently that's me.
The funny thing was I read, because my mom was like, I'm assertive. She took it too and got assertive. And I read them. It was like, what's the difference? And turbulent was all negative. Like there was nothing like, but also turbulent people have this benefit. It's like, no, you're just kind of.
I mean, I've never heard turbulent used in a positive way.
Yeah,
so it checks
kind
out.
Of has a connotation to it.
Uh-huh.
Anyway, well, welcome, sort of. I mean, maybe you're a little more talkative than I am sometimes.
Maybe, because today, apparently, I'm 65 extrovert, 35 introvert.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't look at the numbers, but mine was pretty high, I think. People think I'm an extrovert, but... Or maybe they don't.
I think it's because we're good at talking, and so that, like, gives away, like, alludes that, like, we're very, like...
Yeah, we're
open
also
to being social,
loud. So there's that.
Wait a minute, you're onto something.
Everyone's
now.
Turning the volume down in their car.
Yeah.
Anyway, well, we have a couple of things too. Oh, you had another one, didn't
I
you?
I did, and I wanted to apologize to you because
to me?
Yes, and I know you're going to tell me that I'm being silly, and I know you're going to tell me that
what?
I have no reason to apologize. But I like lost sleep over last night.
What?
That, because of the. Fucking the comment again that I made yesterday of classy trash.
Why? Like, we've literally had this we've had this conversation separately outside from the podcast multiple times where I'm just like so into it
and
gets mad when I bring it up.
Well, I got mad. I'm mad at myself. I'm not mad at you. I'm projecting. Because
I know,
but so here's the thing.
Okay.
So last night I was like, I couldn't fall asleep and I was like, I can't believe on the radio I literally called her fucking
I'm
trash.
From Ohio, like I get it.
Well, so I decided that I was I spent like all night trying to find
what did you do?
Well, because I remember I said I was like,
there's
you
a
look
photo.
Like no, there isn't a photo. I tried though, but I was like, you look like something and I don't know how to describe it, and then classy trash is what came out of my mouth, and I was like, there's got to be a better way to phrase what the hell I meant. So I did a bunch of I went on a bunch of Vogue magazine inserts to like figure out what style.
You made me
I was
a vision board in your head?
In my head, yes.
Okay,
not
so
in real
I'm INFPT and?
Definitely turbulent. And here's what I broke it down to, because there is a list where it's like the 40 main types of women's style.
40, got it.
So I went through the 40 and I was like, okay, it's a hybrid of a couple of these. So I nailed it down to, I think, two. And it actually goes well with today. Like, I would still, my first rough draft would say this is also classy trash.
Great.
But
my
what?
First rough draft.
The rough draft. And now my second draft, I would call it Boho Farmhouse.
Whoa!
Or Modern Cottagecore. That's what I got it to. So
Cottagecore.
Yeah.
Wow. I like that.
It's like, because it's like comfy but chic.
Yes.
Comfy chic, I guess, is really what the final draft
is. Oh, well, shit. Maybe you should have just said it out loud. I like cottagecore. It sounds a little scary.
It's like if Little House on the Prairie happened today, but like they were kind of like in a city, but like they're trendy.
They had TikTok or something.
Like Trendy Prairie, yeah. You know.
Trendy Prairie. We like to come up with
Little House in the City. Okay.
Christ. Okay.
Anyway, that's where we are.
Well, thank you. You're welcome. I mean, I loved, I'm not going to lie to you, I really liked the rough draft also. So I might.
Like Boho Farmhouse. I feel like that's also kind of working with you. I don't know.
Boho Farmhouse sounds like something you would like and I would like. It sounds like a good combo. Uh-huh. So I feel like it fits also. So thank you.
So there you go. I wanted to do a corrections corner on myself, even though it was not needed. But there you
go. Well, I appreciate it deeply. And now I have more words to.
Now if Blaze ever says, like, what style are you going for? You've got quite a range.
Yeah, Blaze asked me most days what style I'm going for that day, especially when we're both at home all days and I wear the same pants every day. And by pants, I mean no pants.
But so today you actually brought new pants to the studio.
It's because I was wearing pants with a zipper and I went, I don't enjoy this anymore. I don't know why I did this. Thank you. So I bought these joggers and I was at Target and I realized this was coming out in October and I thought Halloween's coming up. So I bought this Drink Up Witches shirt.
Looks good.
And
you really can rock an olive green, like none other.
It's one of my favorite colors.
You're lucky it's like in these days. It is. I know because I just looked up all the styles last night.
Yeah, I feel a lot of luck that olive green is in.
Mustard.
And mustard, another one of my favorite colors. And that one piece swimsuits are back. Thank in God. Style. I was isn't not having, excited it, about not that. Having it with the other situation.
Remember the monokini for a second?
Oh boy.
That was just trash.
That hurts.
I think that was classy trash.
Chrissy Teigen's the only one that like really pulled that off. So good bless. Anyway, well, also happy almost spooky season or happy spooky season. I started decorating my house already.
Oh, me too.
Yeah, it is looking great.
The cockroaches are impressed.
Yeah, the cockroaches are loving all
like,
the.
Wow, like, where like, am I?
Fake spider webs mixed with the real cockroach nest. And then, I had an update, a ghosty update.
Oh, hell yeah.
That I wanted to bring up on the show. So since it's spooky season. So something else weird happened because a lot of people ask like, oh, are you still seeing ghosts or whatever? Are you still hearing voices? And I haven't heard voices in a long time. And then it was right after I got home from my last trip. So it was like end of August, I would say a couple weeks ago. I was talking to Blaze about, he was sitting on the haunted sofa, you know, and I was talking to Blaze.
As you do, where do you sit that isn't haunted you in your do. House?
Poor Blaze. And I was talking about the live show, and like it turns out the virtual live show, he had turned it off because it scared him too much, which aww. I thought was like a good sign, kind. Right? I was yeah. like, that's a big compliment. So I was talking to him about it, and then like out of the corner of my eye, I saw something going down the stairs again, and I went, oh, it's Gio. And then Blaze was like, up. Look, and I turned around and Gio was over there, and I was like, and he's like, Christine, I don't want to hear this. Like, don't say this to me. Because it was right above his head. And I
went,
okay.
Remember when we started the show and he was a skeptic?
Yeah, he's not having it anymore, especially in his own house now. And so then I heard footsteps upstairs and I was like, okay, it's got to be the cat because my cat stomps a lot.
Mm-hmm. It's got big ass feet.
Certainly was not the cat either because he was also downstairs. So we were like, well, this is fun for us. And then that night I woke up like this does not happen often because, you know, you and I both have sleep troubles, but I like woke up like in with like startled
in a
awake
panic.
Yeah, and I woke up and I was just like wide awake and everything was like silent, and then all of a sudden like my heart was racing, and then a few seconds later every like phone and electronic device in our room like pinged, like it was being plugged in, and I realized like the power had just like shut off and turned back on. Like everything lit up and pinged all at once that was plugged in, all the alarm clock, whatever.
Uh-huh.
We don't have an alarm clock. I'm not like 100, but okay. You know what I mean. And so everything like the iPad and our phones went like the plug-in noise. And I was like, what the hell? So I was like, oh, the power must have like gone out for some reason. And then I went to my like ADT security app and it was like, no cut to power, like no issue with the power.
So something is fucking with your electronics
in our room
now, and it was such an incredible energetic surge that it also woke you up.
It woke me up before it happened, which really freaked me out. So I was
so
like,
I wanted you to see
I don't it. Yeah, it was uncomfortable at best. And then so I'm like lying there and I'm like, I just need to go back to bed. And I like all of a sudden I heard the stomping, and it was Junie this time, and he walked in, and he like, I don't know, he has never done this before, but he walks in, jumps on the bed, walks directly up to my face, and just like
stares
into my eyes. And
he's
I was
like, bitch, are I know. You seeing this?
I know. And I was like frozen because I was like, hi, Juniper, like, can I help you? I don't know what you're doing. And he just kind of breathed. Like, I could feel him breathing. He was that close to my face. And then he just stood back up, walked out the door. and I just like went back to bed. But it was like the most unsettling. He got in your face
being like, you better fucking fix this.
Yeah, he was like, what have you done? Anyway, it was just very unsettling. And it all happened in like a 3-hour period. And I was like, this something. It was when I was saying, oh, I haven't had anything creepy happen in a long time. And
yeah,
and
the ghost was like, okay.
Anyway, so that's my little update. The thing with the everything turning off and on at once after I woke up with a start was really unsettling. And then Juniper was like watching. It was very creepy. Anyway.
Well, there's our weekly reminder that I'm never flying to Ohio. Okay. Well, we have one last update that's very important.
Oh, oops.
I'm not trying to totally take that away from you.
Oh, I know what it is.
Yeah, take it away.
No.
Oh, no.
It is that we finally did our gift videos, as we were saying, and we opened the big gift that we mentioned that a bunch of people apparently got together and gave us a gift, the patron group.
Yeah, Eva apparently knew. Okay, Eva also super downplayed it, but maybe they also downplayed it to her. Yeah. I don't think any of us knew what was going on, but basically, we haven't been able to open our gifts, or we've also been lazy, and in the last two times you were here, we said we would do it and then didn't, but we've had a lot of gifts since quarantine began,
right?
That we needed to open. And so we decided to like do like a series of videos where we opened up a bunch of them. And in the very last video we did, which you can see all these if you're a patron of ours.
Oh, we got a wooden dildo.
We got two wooden dildos. Thank God.
Thank finally. It's about time.
I finally have seen it all.
Yeah. and was like, what is this? I was like, hello, it's a wooden dildo. Don't you remember?
Someone like in their own like wood shop made us.
They smell great.
We have a lot of gifts of Christine rubbing them all over her face.
A lot of pictures of it. Yeah.
Just because it smelled good. But so in the last video that we did was our final gift that we opened. Apparently, a lot of people in the Patreon Facebook group have been like getting together and arranging this big birthday gift for us that Eva was kind of in on. And Eva said like, oh, well, they're just so you know, like one of the bigger packages is going to be from
like a group
of people. And so when I heard group, I assumed like a couple people like group chat,
like a friend group or something.
Yeah, like they like, you know, I didn't think it was as many as it was, but we opened this gift and the first thing we saw was this card where it was like 200 people had all gotten together.
Yes. And unbelievable.
Not only gotten us some amazing gifts, which we're about to discuss, but on top of the wonderful gifts that we got, they also all together donated $1,000 to three different charities.
Yeah, to Black Lives Matter, the Bail Project, and the Cincinnati Bail Fund. And I started like,
you started weeping.
I was weeping. I was like really crying. But we also opened it and I was like, what could be in this big box? Like a giant lemon. And we literally pulled out a giant lemon.
It was like a massive lemon purse.
Yes. It was like a big Kate Spade lemon purse, which I've already packed in my suitcase as if I'm going anywhere cool and hip and trendy.
We'll take a picture of it and put it here for
so
you.
So cute.
Also, if you're watching the YouTube, how old am I? Also, we each got if you don't know what Crown and Paw is, shout out to them.
Oh my God.
But we each got a little canvas painting I got one of Gio. It's his head on Captain America's body.
It's like a painting. It looks like an oil painting.
It's a wonderful, I should put it, if I had a fireplace, it would be above the fireplace.
And I got the like farmer and his wife, which apparently is actually a farmer and his daughter, I learned, but of Gio and Juniper, and it looks beautiful.
I would pay so much.
Yes.
It should be in a museum.
Yes, it should.
Like,
and it
this
will.
Isn't tomfoolery here.
No. This is no tomfoolery.
And then. Arguably, the best thing that happened was I dug to the bottom of this box, and all of a sudden I saw this large box that said Back to the Future Part 2 on it, and I stopped dead in my tracks, and I looked at Christine, and I said, I think I'm hallucinating. I need you to look in here and tell me if you also see this.
You stopped breathing.
Because I knew what was in it the second I saw that box. Because I know what was in that box because I've been wanting them since I was 8 years old. And now I officially own the Nike Air Mags.
Dun, dun, dun. And they're light up, by the way.
They're lit up.
Back to the Future.
These are not the like $60,000 ones that auto lace. Very disappointed in you guys. But
saying, I was like, if they donated $1,000 to charity and then gave you $50,000 shoes, I think we'd have a lot to talk about.
I have wanted these since I was a child.
But they're like so cool.
It's also I'm wearing my Back to the Future Part 2 hat.
Right.
I told Christine she's lucky I didn't even think about bringing my hoverboard or my jacket today.
I feel very lucky. Thanks.
Could have gotten real crazy today. Yeah. But so this is, I've wanted these shoes forever. They light up.
They're gorgeous.
They've got the little like the blue spackling on it. And Etsy has a couple delightful shops where you can get all the extra modifications to make them look like super legit. So I've already purchased those.
Oh, and sorry, they also included like a little cork USB drive that thumbnail.
My dumbass, I literally thought they gave us a wine cork. And then Christine was like, no, it looks like you pulled it apart.
So I was like, don't throw it on the trash.
And it was a USB.
And they apparently all gave us birthday messages on there. And I haven't been able to, our dumb computers don't have a USB drive. So we're going to watch it later today. But wow, it really, that was heart stopping. Like we were totally taken aback. So thank you. And thank you to everyone else who mailed gifts, especially that it took us months to even get to open them.
We're sorry. I just want to blame COVID every way I can, but also it was partially
it was just hard. Whenever I would visit, together, we had like a million things to do and it always got pushed. As much as like it's shocking that Em and I pushed back opening presents, it sounds like impossible, but it happened.
Usually, like, for example, you were only here for like 48 hours and like we had to do like
I'm here for 4 days. But
are you?
Yes. But
I thought yesterday was the first day I saw you. Space camp.
Yeah,
video
I got there before. 2 days ago and then I leave tomorrow. But
fucking feels like 48 hours. Has not been
does
very
not feel
long.
Like 48 hours to me. I can tell you that much.
The person who didn't travel. Yeah. It feels like I've only seen you.
It ends up being 5 days
for a full day.
It's a long time. We've hung out a lot. We hung out 3 days in a row now.
I know.
Okay. Well, anyway, so it's hard to get everything in, but we did that finally. So we'll post those on Patreon. And we're just really thankful for everybody.
Yes. Sorry this was such a long intro, but a lot to catch
you
up on.
But I'm also really excited about my stories today. It's just so wild and creepy. Like, I lost sleep last night. I was so creeped out.
Oh, shit.
So, spooky time. Spooky season is beginning.
So I think we can probably all agree that the perfect diet doesn't really exist. So despite eating a balanced diet, getting all the nutrients you need for your body to thrive can be really difficult. And, you know, as someone with a chronic illness, sometimes it's really hard for me to know whether I'm absorbing the right things, whether I'm even if I'm eating a healthy diet, that I'm getting all the right stuff. Thankfully, our new sponsor that I'm obsessed with is Athletic Greens.
If there is one thing that you are looking for, one product that has as much high quality nutrients in it as possible, then you're going to want to consider Athletic Greens. With as many as 75 vitamins, minerals, and whole food sourced ingredients, you'd be hard pressed to find a more nutrient dense formula on the market. It has a multivitamin, multimineral, greens complex, probiotic, prebiotic for gut health and immunity formula, digestive enzymes, adaptogens, and I mean, other words I can't say also. Everything.
And you know, the best part is that it actually tastes really good. Like, you wouldn't expect that if you're like, oh, it's just a bunch of healthy things in one powder, but it is really, really excellent tasting. And I know I probably told you about this before, but when it arrived, Blaze was like, did you order that for me? And I was like, no. And he's like, well, I've been wanting to order that for a while from another, you know, so because he had heard of it. So apparently my whole household loves this now. So basically it's a multivitamin that goes the extra mile. Athletic Greens spends the time picking the most bioavailable sources of each ingredient, but they go beyond the multivitamin and they encompass other nutrient categories. I mean, this way you don't need to take like multiple different vitamins. It's sometimes hard to figure out like what you need to add to your regime, to your daily. But if you take Athletic Greens in the morning, you're good to go. You don't even need to worry about taking pills.
Yeah. And it's delivered in an absorbable green powder that Athletic Greens has. It's a superior taste compared to other green multi-formulas. And I got to tell you, before, you know, we were lucky enough to work with them, RJ was obsessed with them, and kind of the same story that you had with Blaze. As soon as it came to our door, he was like, I didn't know I ordered double. And I was like, no, this is mine. And he taught me everything I needed to know about it. He was like, you got to try it. It's so tasty. It's so good. It's going to make you feel great. So I already had a ringing endorsement before I even got on board. And now I'm on it for myself.
And right now, Athletic Greens is giving our audience a special offer on top of their all-in-one formula, which is a free liquid vitamin D supplement with your first purchase for additional immune support. And I actually am deficient in vitamin D. I found out recently, so this was like perfect timing. And actually, many of us are deficient in vitamin D, which is usually produced in our bodies from sun exposure. So adding a vitamin D supplement to your daily routine is a really great way to support vitamin D production, particularly the winter months, which are coming up. And Athletic Greens is giving you up to a 1 year supply for free with your first purchase.
So if you're looking to upgrade your multivitamin or take one nutritional formula that's going to help cover your daily nutritional bases, then you want to consider Athletic Greens. Athletic Greens makes getting as much high quality nutrition as possible incredibly easy without the need to buy multiple products.
Make an investment in your health today and try the ultimate all-in-one wellness bundle and support your immunity, gut health, and energy by visiting athleticgreens.com/drink. You'll receive up to a year's supply of liquid vitamin D for free with your first purchase. Again, that's athleticgreens.com/drink.
Christine, not only are you looking foxy, but there's three other Fs you're looking. Fab, oh, yeah? Fit, and fun. Hey.
Oh, and foxy. Wow, I'm really amplifying the brand, I would say. Folks, Fab, Fit, Fun is our favorite thing ever. I'm so excited that they are our sponsor, as always. So whether it's a Michael Kors Passport wallet or a Tarte Hydrating Moisturizer, the Members Picks box is curated specifically with Fab, Fit, Fun's members' top-rated products from past seasons. And I will tell you that my sister in the last FabFitFun box I got kind of commandeered, you know, what she wanted. And she took that Michael Kors wallet. And now anytime I take her to like Target or whatever, she's just like swinging it around. It's her favorite accessory. And she was just so excited. And so now anytime a FabFitFun box comes, she kind of shows up at my doorstep and wants to dig through it. So we might have to order her a box of her own.
Well, just like you said, the Members Picks box is also on sale now. So it's just even more fab, more fit, and more fun. if you needed a whole extra box, there it is for you.
And when you order your box, you can expect to choose from a wide variety of products. So, you know, depending on what your needs are, what you're kind of feeling for the upcoming seasons, you can pick from the box, pick for your box, whatever you feel like, you know, suits you best.
Yeah, they've got some brand names. They've got Pottery Barn, they've got Gravity, they've got Way, they've got Lumira, they've got Amber Skeets. I mean, the list goes on. I mean,
list really goes on.
Really, yeah. A lot of, I could sit here and list all of them. I'm not going to. Just know that there's some quality stuff.
Some really quality stuff. Exactly. So it's time to customize your box for the fall season. Sign up today to receive your first box and join a community of over 1 million people who are already obsessed, including me and apparently now my sister also.
Use coupon code DRINK for $10 off your first box at www.fabfitfun.com.
That's code DRINK for $10 off your first box at www.fabfitfun.com.
Well, this is one that I thought I had covered. Apparently, I had not. I think I was mistaking it for the Enfield Poltergeist.
Oh, I remember that one.
So this is the Snedeker family haunting.
What's that?
The Snedeker house. This was the inspiration for Haunting in Connecticut, where I think the Enfield Poltergeist was inspiration for The Conjuring.
Got it.
So I think I got those mixed up.
None of that means anything to me, but
great.
I got it.
Well, let's learn about half of it.
I am on my way to understanding what you're saying at the bootleg finish line.
You're almost there.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so this story takes place in 1986, and this the house belonged to Carmen and Al Snedeker. They moved to this house. It was in Southington, Connecticut. And the address of the house, by the way, is 208 Meriden Avenue. I'm only saying it because it does exist all over the internet. You can find the address in a lot of places. But it is a private residence, so
if you're not, like, doxing. Well, you are doxing them, but everyone's doxing them.
It's very easy to find, so okay. I don't feel like I'm, like, spreading private information. It is a private residence, and apparently the people who live there are fine with you taking pictures from the road.
You don't do any further trespass. Especially with this social distancing, like, exactly. We don't need that.
Oh, especially during that. But yeah, so it's in Southington, Connecticut, and Carmen and Al Snedeker moved there from New York to be closer to the UConn hospital. And not UConn, like University of Connecticut, I think. UConn.
Yeah.
Not like Canada, UConn.
I was like, what other UConn is there?
Okay, I was thinking like YUKON.
No, yeah, like UConn, the school.
To be closer to the hospital because they had a son who was dealing with cancer.
Oh, no.
And so they wanted to move closer to the hospital so that they would be able to, so just be easier, sure, on all of them. So I'm going
to... They were like, it's going to be so much easier if we move to this house. And I imagine whatever's coming is not easier.
Right, exactly. Like, oh, we had a great idea. And then it ends up not being a great idea.
No.
So one thing I'm going to say is I am confused about the children's names. It's definitely Carmen and Al are the parents. But different stories have made it sound like there were three kids of theirs and one or two nieces that lived with them.
Okay.
But the nieces either already lived with them or show up later in the story, and I'm not sure what the accurate,
like, the version order is.
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't know if they moved in and the niece also moved with them, or if the niece moved in later.
Okay.
Also, their names are kind of wild. So, like, the son who had cancer.
I mean, their name is Snedeker. Like, it, I'm expecting something.
They're, well, I mean, like, it's, like, based on different stories, there's different names. And I think some stories were for their privacy, but then other places use their actual names. So, and then there's the movie based on them. So they have their own names.
Like, fictional names as well.
So every character I mentioned has, like, three different names.
I see.
And it was, for a while, hard to keep up with, like, oh, who's who. But I know from an actual interview that Carmen and Al did that the son with cancer's name was Steven.
Okay.
Although in a lot of articles, he's known as Philip. And then there's another son that they have named Michael, according to their personal interviews. But a lot of articles named him Bradley.
Well, I know this happens a lot, at least in true crime, where minors are given fake names. Or, yeah, in the media. And then a lot of times later on, the family will refer to them by the real name. And then, yeah, it gets, like, mixed up. So that could be...
I think that maybe that's what I dealt with. And maybe... I also didn't, like, watch the movie in preparation. So maybe Philip and Bradley are the movie names.
Oh, sure.
Or maybe there's a whole other set of names. I'm not sure. But Stephen is officially the son's name.
Got it.
And so they originally moved into this house not only because it was closer to the hospital, but they kind of, like, lucked out, quote, and that it was a very big house that could fit their whole family, which had at least their three kids and maybe one or two nieces.
Got it.
And it was cheap enough for them to also cover their medical bills.
So affordable. Uh-oh.
A big-ass house that's cheap. I wonder what's happened there.
Yeah.
And also... they realized that it had enough rooms when you also included the basement where the boys would be sharing a room.
Nope.
Or at least sharing the space. So on move-in day, apparently Stephen right away said, we have to leave immediately. This house is evil and something bad is going to happen if we stay.
Can you imagine if your kid said that? You'd be like, I just put down a, like, and yeah. I just took out a mortgage on this house. Oh, God.
It's too late.
Sorry, go in the basement.
Again, there's different versions to this story, and I don't know what's necessarily the movie versus what is reality versus what the alleged claims are.
Okay.
So there's, again, three different versions, because I'm going to get to him later, but there's an author named Ray Garten, and he wrote originally they were calling it like a nonfiction book about everything that happened, and he was using as much detail as possible to give as accurate of a story as possible. And then later he says, like, oh no, it's fiction. So, like, you can't even really trust what the archives of this are.
Right.
But the main story is that Al, when they are moving in, goes down to check the basement before the boys start moving their stuff in. And he sees that the room is full of embalming stuff, tables, and medical tools.
Oh, no. And they just left that there? Apparently, they were like, well, it was just abandoned.
They just left all the equipment there. And it apparently, in that room, they also had a chain-powered body lift. And one of the walls either was stained with blood or had a drain for blood.
Goodbye and good night to everyone. I'm not participating in this anymore.
So they realized that the house, I don't know how they realized it or how they got this information, but they find out that the house was called the Hallahan Funeral Home. And the body lift was literally to lift corpses from the basement to the first floor.
Well, yeah, I kind of guessed that at this point. If we're lifting bodies anywhere, I'm imagining.
They also allegedly found a small graveyard out the back.
No.
They also found drawers full of corpse photographs, toe tags, and personal items of the dead.
Oh, can you imagine just like, what's in this drawer? Toe tags.
It's like moving into a totally stocked morgue.
Yeah.
Ugh.
And like not cleaned, apparently, if there's like drains of blood. And that's
where you and little Timmy sleep. Like,
yeah, they're like, he's like, this house is evil. It's like, what? No, not this house.
Can you imagine if you're Al, the dad, and you're like, No, this place isn't evil. Don't worry. Let me go check the basement for you. And then you're like, oh, shit, I can't really tell them
to come down here. It's like that thing where you tell your parents there's a monster and they're like, no, I'll check. Watch. Mom will go in the closet and look. And it's like, mom will open the right. There's a lot of embalming fluid in this drawer. You weren't kidding.
So Carmen and Al actually did one of their interviews that is on YouTube. They were on the show Sally, Jesse, Raphael. Do you remember that show?
No.
It was like, I mean, I don't think it was around during our time. It was like 80s.
Well, I don't know what that
early
is.
Early 90s. So it was our time, but we were obviously not.
Bebes.
We weren't watching it. Yeah. Maybe our moms were. But maybe. It was a talk show.
Oh, no, I don't know it. My mom probably wasn't watching it either. She only watched like, whatchamacallit, Walker, Texas Ranger. And that's it.
I have a hunch my mom was watching Sally, Jesse, Raphael.
I can see Linda watching. I don't even know what it is, and I already know the answer. Yeah.
And so on the show, Carmen said, quote, "I didn't know it was a funeral home when I..." So this is also where the story gets weird, because they say, oh, Al went in there and then he saw this embalming stuff. She says that they found out later, and that there's also some... I'll read the quote in a second. I don't know if it's in this quote or if it comes later, but one of their... one of the other stories that came out was that Al didn't go down there during move-in day and saw all this stuff, but the basement was actually blocked up when they moved in, and it took a while for them to get all that stuff out of the basement and then found that stuff.
Sure. I mean, if it were just full of crap, you probably wouldn't like explore it until you had the time.
So I don't really know, but this is what Carmen had to say on the show.
Okay.
"I didn't know it was a funeral home. When I came in the first time, the downstairs was full of workmen and lumber. When you went down the hallway to your left, there to your left was where there used to be the chapel, which is now our dining room."
Oh my, this is like getting worse and worse.
This sounds like your house right
now. It does. I'm like, oh, what have I done?
Here, now you're a third person party to what I have to hear you talk about in your house.
I get it now.
And then she says, "I got the TV from an estate sale, and there was a dead..." No, I'm kidding.
Oh my God, I went, wait a second. Wow, you got me there. I went like, holy crap.
You were like, oh man.
But I didn't get a TV from an estate sale, okay, everybody?
You got a couch from an estate sale, clear.
No electronics, though, you know.
Well, so to the left was the chapel where the dining room used to be. If you kept going into the kitchen and through our French doors, okay. Oh, what a flex. Oh, yeah. You would get to the basement, which was the morgue.
Got it.
The hoist went up to our bedroom, and to the right of the staircase was a blood tank.
Cool. I'm not going to ask. I don't know. We're all waiting for somebody to ask what that is.
I don't want to know.
I don't either.
I mean, it sounds like it's a tank of blood.
You guys can Google this for yourselves. I'm not interested.
And then as you walked through there, there was a sink where they flushed the blood and things of that nature.
Okay, we're going on with the blood. Got it.
On the sink was makeup and wax used to prepare the bodies. So that was still there. They really like just abandoned it.
They just left.
There were also three coffin pillows. If you went on, you'd find the north coffin room, which is where my son Steven slept. If you made a right, you'd get to the south coffin room where Michael slept.
I'm like so astounded at how extremely ridiculous this is.
That's like starting off pretty strong.
I mean, the second they signed that paperwork, the people selling it were like, thank God it's off our hands.
So, exactly. They're like, wow, I can't believe these poor saps really just bought this place. Whew. So soon they started having experiences like pretty damn... I mean, it was asking to haunt you.
Yeah, not surprised by this.
Just so everyone knows too, like a lot of people would say like, why would you stay? Well, first of all, they... already just got this place because they barely could afford anything else because of all the medical bills for their son. And they were convinced and became more and more convinced over time that the spirits were attached to them. So no matter where they went, it was going to follow them. So they're like, we might as well just stay put.
Right.
So the kids first started hearing footsteps, which kept them up. And then they started hearing the sound of, quote, hundreds of birds taking flight.
Ew, what a weird specific sound.
I don't even know how that would sound.
Like flapping?
Yeah, I just think of like a lot of bats.
That's really freaky.
And they started seeing strange people in the house. Well, like people that were not their family just walking around
like
the house. That's
like an escalation if I ever heard. They heard footsteps and then all of a sudden like...
I heard 100 bats and then I saw a stranger.
And then a man
home.
Was in the bathroom, yeah. Woof.
Let me see. Oh, and then electrical sockets and light bulbs were described as having an unnatural glow or flickering on their own or completely turning off. On their own. So there is one reference that I saw, which I don't know if this is true or not, but apparently, Al was saying that the kids were, this is kind of fucked up, but it like does explain it realistically, not supernaturally. I guess all the kids were saying that they were so scared at night that they were keeping the lights on and Al was afraid of the electric bill.
Sure.
And so he took all the light bulbs out.
Oh no, that's such a dad move.
It's like fucked up that like now the kids are still scared, but it would explain why the lights would magically like disappear or like turn off and they wouldn't be able to turn them on in the middle of the night when they were flipping the switch.
Dad was like, no, no.
Right.
Under this roof.
Steven, apparently, and also he's the one that is very ill.
Yeah.
And it just reminds me, so apparently he was the most afflicted by these spirits.
Right.
And I've said this before on the show, but one of my own friends had a lot of medical issues at one point in her life, and she actually died on the table in the hospital like 12 times.
Right.
And so, and she's the one who has some psychic tendencies.
Mediumship.
And she attributes it, and I also, it makes sense to me. She attributes that she's able to have talents like that just because she has been so close to the other side, mm-hmm. that it's easier to connect with
I've
things.
Heard that, like near-death experiences or like
right.
temporary dying.
Yeah.
Temporary dying, as I mean, they call it.
Kind of temporary death. It's like a quick death.
Yeah, yeah.
Quick coming back. So I think that could be attributed to this,
like
too.
Like thinning the veil each time.
Exactly.
Ooh, spooky, spooky.
So because he is the one that's kind of more ill, then he's probably closer to being able to see them. Or maybe they, I mean, this is really fucked up, but like a lot of people have suggested that when you're sick, because there's less, quote, life.
Vitality.
Yeah, you're easier to...
you're, like, more vulnerable.
Your soul is easier to manipulate or something like that, which I don't know how I feel about that, but
yeah,
heard it before.
It's
a theory.
But even like they say with teenagers that you're more susceptible to poltergeist because you have so much more like frenetic energy or like hormones happening. So I wonder if there's any connection with like if you're...
When your energy is out of whack, they will take a hold of it, whether it's you've got too much energy or not enough.
Right.
So he started immediately seeing things. I mean, day one, he said this place is evil. So like that should have been the first sign. The family thought that he was hallucinating from his medications. Although like they went to doctors and said, like, he says he's seeing people. He says he's hearing things. But the doctors were like, that's not a side effect of his medication.
Do we know how old he is?
I mean, he was a teenager.
Okay.
He's
old enough. He's not like three and being like, I see.
No. He's the oldest of the kids.
He's like, this isn't normal. I know that this is not normal.
He's like, he's seeing something. Right. Yeah. And the doctors were like, no, like, that's not a side effect of his medicine.
Wow.
And Carmen, like, at first, obviously didn't believe them because the smaller kids were also seeing things. And she figured out that, or she assumed at least that, well, they know it's a funeral home and we, like, gave him a lot of PTSD with them walking into a morgue and saying, this is where we live now. So maybe they're just like coming up with stories.
Move the embalming fluid aside and put your coffin pillow.
Put your toothpaste there.
Put your coffin pillow on the bed and lay down.
Exactly. So
oh my gosh.
She's like, they're probably just trying to like process that we live in a funeral home.
I get it.
Yeah. And so throughout the first months of living at the house, apparently Stephen also started showing radical personality shifts. Like angry, super irritable, super violent. There is also, I saw one source that said that he allegedly broke into the neighbor's house and like got a gun and said that he was going to use it on Al.
Oh my God. His dad?
Yeah. I don't know if that's true, but that was, something that was out there for the world. And I think, I don't know if that was necessarily true, but most sources said that he was incredibly angry and super irritable and not himself. And the parents thought that maybe it was just adolescence or a reaction to like his radiation treatment. And like, they were like, we're not going to bother him. Like, he probably feels like garbage.
Right.
Like, I'd be mad too. And then they realized that the son was turning his anger towards like just writing poetry just as an outlet.
Aww.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-oh.
But it was all about necrophilia. Yeah.
Empathy.
So what's the
empathy,
but in reverse.
Schultz.
What's aw in reverse?
Wow. It's actually the sound of 100,000 bats just like flying out of my soul and leaving my husk behind.
Bingo. So this is where I'm confused. Like, apparently at this point his cousin was already living there. That must have been the case because what happens next is he attacks his cousin. And trigger warning, but it's implied that he tried to sexually assault her.
Oh, no.
And apparently that happened a few times. And that's the end of that. So if that's a trigger warning for you, we're done talking about it. It's over.
Okay.
But
until we get to my story, which, as we know, at this point, every trigger
every
warning
bullet point
is
applicable a trigger
point. Every episode.
Apparently he tried attacking his cousins. And again, there's that rumor that he grabbed a gun to hurt his dad. So... basically the parents immediately, like, they heard that that happened to the cousin. Sure. I don't know if he did it or he just said he was, like, considering it or something, but they took him out of that fucking house. And they were like, they put him in a mental institution for a while to get to just check, like, his vitals and make sure that he's like, what is going on?
Take,
like,
his temperature.
Take his temperature. Maybe, like, read him a book. Let's calm him down.
Heart rate's a little high.
So they found out that on top of his like, his already horrible illness, that he was also unmedicated, or he wasn't even diagnosed yet for schizophrenia. So they ended up diagnosing him with that.
Can you imagine that double? I mean, that's horrifying.
I can't imagine going through all of that in your mind, like, all at the same time. That's got to be really something else. So they got him on the right medication for that. He was doing better. And after being there for 45 days, they brought him home.
I'm glad we addressed the minute. I was like, I think there's, because we always, we sometimes walk that fine, not we, but, like, the stories walk that line of, like, when we talk about, like, old-timey hauntings, and it's right. Is this maybe mental illness that was not detected or not taken seriously?
Yeah, the second I always see the note, like, oh, and they started seeing things, I'm like, okay, but were other people confirming this?
Right. Like, or especially when it comes to, like, sexually assaulting someone.
Right.
And the, you know, that kind of.
And also, like, wanting to, like, violently hurt your parents. You
right.
know?
Right. Right. Right.
So.
Okay. Well, I'm glad that at least that was clarified a little bit. Wow.
So according to that guy's book, the Ray Garten, who now they're saying, like, his book was, like, just a bunch of, like, sensationalized nonsense. Oh. Ray says that Stephen actually admitted to his family that he did all those horrible things, that he, like, said he had attacked people in his family. In the book, it says that Stephen admitted to actually doing these violent things.
Okay.
But then again, like, we don't know if he was just trying to sensationalize the whole thing or...
The author, you mean?
If the author's lying. So this basically, aside from that whole, like, ball of wax... While he was gone and the spirits weren't attached to him, they started focusing on the rest of the family.
I see. So there's still ghosts happening here.
Yes. Yeah, so, like, on top of, like, cancer and schizophrenia and assault, there's also spirits.
And toe tags.
Right. So while he was gone for those 45 days, the spirits took likings to other family members.
No!
And basically when he came home, it the spirits came right back to him. But it took a year for Carmen to start believing the kids, and it was when the nieces, Kelly and Trisha, I think are their names, when they moved in with them. I guess they moved in with them because their parents were getting divorced, and the Snedekers were like, well, you can come stay with us.
Sure.
I guess the ghosts weren't that bad yet, or, like,
I know.
Maybe Carmen still, you know, didn't believe in them.
We have plenty of room.
So she was like, oh, the kids think the place is haunted, but you can come stay with us.
Ugh.
Okay.
What?
I'm trying to tread this lightly because
you're scaring me.
It's not paranormally scary, but if you are someone who if a trigger for you is sexual assault, it gets kind of weird here. This story, we find out that the ghosts become succubus and incubuses.
Oh no.
Which, if you don't know what those are, they are spirits that it's the creepy little thing that also their MO is to sexually assault you.
Okay.
So yeah. I won't get really in depth, but we are gonna toe that line. So if that is something that you cannot listen to, then I would skip ahead maybe a minute.
Yep.
Starting now. So one night Kelly got into bed and she felt an unseen hand groping her. And that was apparently not the first time. And hands started moving under the covers that weren't there. They tugged at her underwear, and she felt hands on her body where they shouldn't have been. She heard scratching on the walls. She heard voices, and she saw a black mask over her. Kelly also felt her bra straps being pulled down. She'd feel icy hands on her, and she
Jesus.
Apparently she tried to. She was holding onto a rosary. And she could feel something trying to peel her hand open.
Oh, no, no, no,
so she couldn't hold the rosary.
Oh, no, 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 no.
And she said that she felt like the bed was vibrating or breathing. And the rosary on the nightstand, eventually the cross fell off on its own. Like it, like, popped off the rosary.
God. Oh, my God.
So she ran to Carmen. And Carmen sat with her and read the read the Bible, but that was when she realized, that was when Carmen realized that there were spirits here, because she saw for herself movement under Kelly's shirt as if a hand should have been there.
Oh, God.
Like, saw a hand, wrist, arm kind of like go up a shirt and outside.
Ew.
Yeah. So that was when Carmen realized what was going on. And so they ran downstairs. They ran to the dining room / chapel and prayed. And the incubus started getting more aggressive now towards Carmen and Al. This is kind of, and by kind of, I mean very fucked up.
Oh.
But on Sally, Jesse, Raphael, Carmen and Al reenacted it.
What?
With like studio lighting and music.
Oh my God.
Which also makes people wonder, like, okay, this must be a hoax, because nobody who's ever been a survivor of assault, like, happily talks about it super openly on a television show, like, in a studio setting. Like, and maybe some people are comfortable and have, like, coped with it enough where they can talk about it, but they were talking about it like it wasn't even hard for them to go back to.
I wonder if it's different, though. I mean, not. I wonder if it being a paranormal thing is just more detached feeling, maybe.
Maybe.
I mean, not that I'm saying, oh, that was probably a fine experience for everyone, but like,
sure.
I wonder if it's just, I imagine that if this is an experience where, you know, a stranger or whomever
could be more, much more traumatic,
and, right,
versus not being able to see something.
And it seems less.
I don't know, but then you could also argue it'd be super scary that, like, you can't see what's happening.
Well, yes. And I think, I imagine that a talk show in the, was it 80s or whatever, or at any point, is probably going to have an easier time making light of it.
Sure.
If it's...
To be fair, it was never... No, there was no, like, audience laughter or anything. Like, they weren't trying to make it funny, but they were still... And also, I'm speaking as one person, and I have no right in making a sweeping generalization on this, but it came across as, like, they were very, very casual about it, when I would have not been so open to that.
Right.
So I don't know. It just, that was just, a lot of people have said, like, they were really casual about it. Like,
I wonder if it's, like, also explaining it, because I feel like you don't have to demonstrate what.
Right. And all they did was sit in the bed. They didn't, like, reenact anything graphic. They just, for some reason, Sally, Jesse, Raphael, one of them in a bed while they told the story.
Well, yeah. I feel like there's probably some really amped up producers are being like, oh, yeah, let's get the most out of this.
Also, I imagine in the 80s, like that, yeah, like you said, like that was probably taken a lot more lightheartedly.
Yeah.
Anyway, I'm sorry for like talking about that, but also you should be warned that
it's interesting.
If this is something that you wouldn't want to see on a talk show, maybe don't go watch the interview on YouTube.
Right. Ugh.
So without getting into a lot of detail, they, both Al and Carmen, said that they were both completely assaulted by this thing many times.
Okay, that's just beyond.
And
I hope that's not a hoax. I mean, I hope it's a hoax, because I don't want
to. I hope it's a hoax, but I also hope that it's.
But that would be like so horrifyingly fucked up if you're like, let's make up this story, you know?
Yes.
So I'm hoping it's not real, but I'm also like, what?
You know what we mean. I don't want this to have happened. But
of course.
Also, please, God,
tell me they're not making this up. Right.
So apparently they would know something was about to happen because they would hear music from the 1930s and they would hear multiple men laughing.
Oh, my God.
Which is awful.
This is horrible. This is really freaky.
Now that I've said that, I promise I'm not talking about this stuff anymore for the rest of the story. But it is a big part that I think should be brought up. First of all, I would feel like an asshole if I didn't.
Sure.
If I like tried to like
skim over it,
throw that under the rug. But also, if you plan on looking further into the story, you should be prepared that like this is the stuff that you're gonna see.
Yes.
Okay. So that all the violent stuff is happening, confirmed by not just the nieces but Al and Carmen.
Now that
They also said that all of their beds regularly felt like they were breathing or vibrating, which is really weird. They also said that they would see little like footprints on the bed that looked like a cat, like a ghost cat walking around. But then they would feel like, but then you could even see the indents of like tiny little footsteps walking on the bed. But then all of a sudden you would see the indent and you would feel like the weight of a grown man sit on the bed. So it's kind of like, were those little cat footprints, or was it a guy standing by the bed doing this with his fingers and then sitting
down? That's so much worse.
It's all bad. It's all bad. So indents on the bed, potentially a cat. I pray to God it's a fucking cat.
Yeah, me too.
Let's see. Apparently, there were times where they would literally like be running out of their house and they would feel something like trying to chase them. Michael once saw the ghosts, and this kind of confirms the cat theory, that when he saw the ghosts a few times, but when he first saw them, they looked different than how they slowly transitioned to look for him. In the beginning, they looked like they had cat-like eyes.
Ew!
And they would be on his ceiling staring at him while he slept.
Okay, I don't love that.
And then it turned more into like a general black mass, but his sister... He would hear his sister laughing, or he would see the lights turning on and off by themselves.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
So Carmen also said the spirits would, and going into like his sister would be laughing. Obviously, his sister was not actually laughing. It was something impersonating his sister.
Sure.
And Carmen said that the spirits love to impersonate the children. She would regularly hear them calling for her from another room. And then over time, once she got familiar with that, it would stop doing that, and it started becoming a much more guttural, raspy voice cussing her out from different rooms. Spirits would again follow them, and not just follow them, like, you know, they would feel unsafe in random other buildings, but like if you were in a building away from your home, they would also like mess with the electronics there.
That's like scary. So it's like attached to them.
Yeah, like machines would malfunction. One time Al's car, he drove somewhere and he got out of his car. The car started itself and drove into a building.
What?
I don't know if maybe he just forgot to like park the car and like he's saying, no, it's
really shitty driver.
That's
the only upside to all of this, is you'd at least have something to blame if you messed up
at
any point in your life.
How do you call an insurance company though and be like, listen, the ghost turned the
car
on?
You definitely don't. You lose that one. You lose it.
So Carmen also said she would mop the floors and the water would turn into blood.
Cute.
And when other people would come into the room, it would change before they could see it. So she was alone in that experience.
And that's like that whole thing of making you feel
crazy.
Yeah. Or like insecure or in your own beliefs or whatever.
And the house started smelling like rotting flesh every now and then.
Cute.
Good stuff. Items would go missing. Crucifixes apparently turned upside down.
No, I don't like that.
This sounds pleasant. Dishes would put themselves away.
That's absolutely...
That's the best part of this whole story.
Absolutely, 100% something I need.
But apparently it was like at inconvenient times. Like the kids would set the table for dinner.
Oh.
And then as they're sitting down or they'd turn around, they'd be like, where the fuck are the dishes? And they'd be back in the cabinet.
I bet that's also like... Now this is just me going way past our finish line and like making shit up. But I wonder if also part of it is pitting them against each other.
Right.
Like separating, like saying... Oh, you're seeing this thing, but as soon as you call in your husband, he's not going to see it. And, oh, the kids are going to set the table, but now we're going to make you think they didn't. And
Steven's like, no, I already put the dishes out. And then he gets in trouble. And then the mom's like, no, I did mop the floor, but there's blood everywhere. And the dad's like, no, I didn't drive the car into the building.
And then everyone's like, Dad, you definitely drove the car.
Like, Dad, that one's for sure on
that
you.
That one's you.
And the younger brother, apparently, I don't know why he put himself in this situation, but apparently... He once like got on one of the gurneys and then it started spinning uncontrollably and he couldn't get off of it.
Oh, no.
And also that was a scene from the movie. So I don't know if it's more exaggerated in the movie than it is in real life. Maybe he like just couldn't get off the gurney. But
I was going to say, the second it starts rolling, I'm like, help. So
if it rolled a little
an inch
where I could definitely get off of it, I would tell everyone for the rest of my life.
You and
it
I
spun uncontrollably.
Would be like, what?
The one time the shower curtain wrapped itself around Carmen so she couldn't breathe. Her niece had to pull her out of the shower.
Nope.
Apparently Carmen also saw demons, and this was how she described one of them. One was very thin with high cheekbones with long black hair and black eyes. The other had white hair and eyes and wearing a pinstriped tuxedo.
Oh God.
And his feet were constantly in motion. So I just imagine like someone standing tap dancing. Really,
I just picture like walking but not going anywhere. But yeah, that's what I picture. But either way, it's bad. It's all bad, as we like to say.
Let me see. Where were we? Oh, yes. The tap dancing thing. So eventually they got fed up. Can you believe it? And they contacted the Warrens, who were like fresh off their Amityville high. And so
riding high,
they brought, so the Warrens actually brought their nephew John to come with them, and they brought some other investigators, and they were there for, I think, 9 weeks. And while investigating, the team saw people getting like slapped and beaten and slammed to the floor, and like, just,
oh my God.
I mean, these things were not hiding themselves. They also heard the body lift chains moving on their own.
That's no good.
This is a quote from Lorraine in a separate interview from Sally Jesse Raphael. Lorraine said, in the basement, it was absolutely terrible. When I walked down in the basement area, I wasn't afraid of the darkness. It was the dark, oppressive feeling as I walked around the home. That was absolutely horrifying, just horrifying. And the more I walked from the first room, and the more I walked from the first room that was a bedroom, which we were to find later was referred to as the North Coffin Room, something horrible had occurred in this place, and I could see all the charred bodies. Because remember, she was the medium between them. So,
oh,
like,
that sucks.
So Lorraine, like, in there, I think the way it went is whenever the Warrens would go into a house, they did a walkthrough, and she would just kind of go into her own zone, and she would use her mediumship.
Right.
And try to sense spirits who were there. And all she saw were charred bodies.
Oh, my God.
And in that interview, they said, like, out of all the cases you've done, if you were to rate this, like, 1 to 10, what would you call this? And she said this was a 7.
Wow.
And she said 10 is, like, full-blown exorcist possession.
Okay. That's pretty high up there.
7 is, like, not a house I want to live in.
I'd prefer not.
And so one night during the investigation, Carmen was actually lying down in bed, and she remembers she wasn't doing anything. Like, the Warrens didn't ask her to do anything. She just, on her own, ended up in this 8-hour-long trance.
Oh, no.
And this is a quote from Carmen on that. I was transported into complete darkness. I couldn't feel the temperature of my own skin. I couldn't hear myself speak. I couldn't see anything but blackness. The entity opened up a hole above me and started shouting obscenities at me, which got worse if I prayed. So if she prayed,
what was it trying to do, you think? Take her soul away?
Maybe. She was apparently transported to this world that she, like, inherently knew was called Ethereum.
Whoa. Okay.
Which was, quote, a desert road of hot tears, and I was taken down this road of souls where I could feel the anger, the emotion, the hurt, the desperation, the sadness through my skin.
What the fuck?
Yikes. Apparently, around this time, John, the Warren's nephew, was down sitting in the dining room. And this is a quote from him. He said, the room got bitterly cold. I could sense a presence around me, and I saw an apparition starting to form. Mm. And as this happened, John smelled a, quote, disgusting odor so foul that it restricted his breathing. And he heard the sounds of flapping wings.
Uh-huh.
And the apparition slowly walked down the stairs, staring at him. And apparently it was the ugliest thing he'd ever seen.
This is really freaky.
The thing got down to the last step, turned towards him and said, do you know what they did to us? And John apparently left the house and didn't come back for 3 days.
I can't believe he came back at all, but okay. Whoa.
The Warrens were also there to either confirm. I think they were the ones who were the first people to say this to the family. But the Warrens found out on their own that necrophilia had happened in the house, which would explain why Stephen was writing poetry about that, and they were attached to him, and
yikes,
you know what I mean?
Yeah,
it's just a weird coincidence.
It
so
is, yeah.
The Warrens found out that necrophilia had occurred in the funeral home, which probably is what caused the demons, because the energies weren't at rest. So they brought in a priest, and things were fine for a few days after the priest blessed the house. But pretty soon after, Carmen and Al had objects thrown at them. There were scratches on the kids' bodies, and the Warrens decided that they needed a full-ass exorcism with multiple priests.
Full-ass,
full booty cheeks.
Let's all go.
So they did it, like, they brought in a bunch of priests, had a huge exorcism, and apparently this was on September 6th, 1988. And this was, keep in mind, they moved in 1986.
Wow.
So this is 2 years of this
nightmare.
So it was a 3-hour exorcism. Apparently during it, the dishes rattled, picture frames shook, there was banging in the walls, and two of the priests left because they couldn't handle it. After the exorcism, the last thing that they saw was a red footprint on the living room floor.
Oh.
They don't know what that means.
Goodness.
But apparently it was
there
after.
The last remaining thing.
Maybe like it was walking out. I don't know. But their nephew, John, the Warren's nephew, he said, quote, "The house definitely felt lighter and the smell of roses came upon us. We all felt a sense of calm and relief." And the Snedekers ended up living there for a couple more years without any problems.
Wow.
They moved to Tennessee. Stephen, unfortunately, he did go into remission for a while, but it came back in 2012 and he passed. He's buried in Elizabethton, Tennessee. And the family has been on national talk shows. In 2002, there was a documentary about them. In 2009, The Haunting in Connecticut came out. There is controversy, like I've been mentioning, that the family, maybe a lot of the family maybe didn't experience the activity, but made it up because they needed the money for medical bills for their son.
Oh, no. That's a weird way to go about it, though.
So they think, like, maybe if they stirred up enough attention. I mean, they were in Connecticut, which isn't far from, you know, upstate New York. Amityville had just happened. So maybe they were like, if we draw up enough attention, we can get the Warrens here, publicize this. A lot of people think that they wanted to do this for the press tour and all that so that they could get the money.
But it is also hard because I feel like if you talk about it, then people immediately are like, it's a hoax. But if you don't talk about it, then like
nothing happens.
People are like, why aren't you talking about, why aren't you telling people? So it's a weird, like,
that's the big crux of it, or that's it. Like the big assumption is that it was for medical bills.
Sure.
Which, like, I understand wanting to do anything for your kid that's sick.
Yeah.
And but at the same time, like, when you think about, like, the assault accusations and all that, you could have just said you had ghosts, you know?
Right. And I think, well, I wonder too, maybe if,
or maybe it happened,
you know? Maybe some of it happened and maybe they were like, let's amp this up.
So that's another theory.
Like, make it. Oh.
You know, you're on track here. So you're
that's never happened before.
You are what is it again? You're on your way to understanding.
I'm on my way to understanding what you're talking about.
So Daryl Kern is the former owner of the building, and he confirmed that the building was Hallahan Funeral Home.
Okay.
But like I said earlier, Carmen has said, like, well, we didn't know it was a funeral home until later. So neighbors say that the family absolutely knew it was a funeral home, even though they're saying, oh, we didn't know until we moved in and moved things around. No. Everyone that knows them for the most part is like, there was literally a sign that said funeral home on the house.
Oh,
but Carmen says, like, well, it was covered with plywood because they had closed up shop and then we were moving in, so we never saw, because it was under plywood. We never saw.
Yeah, I guess maybe if you're frantically trying to move in while dealing with the health issues, maybe you would just kind of like skipped over that.
So a lot of people are on either side of that, being like, okay, if it literally said funeral home, like, you could have known if you took the plywood off. Maybe there was no plywood on it at all. Yeah. Who knows? A lot of neighbors say that they never heard about any activity until all of a sudden they started getting behind on their rent. And so all of, like, that they're saying, like, well, we didn't hear anything. But then you can argue, like, well, they were probably dealing with this privately, and then it came out in the middle of them also trying to figure out rent. Another big argument for, like, this is a hoax is that the house they were in was a duplex, and they had an upstairs tenant who never had a fucking ghost.
Oh, no.
And so a lot of people were like, why on earth, like, wouldn't she at least hear something?
Oh, weird. You know? Yeah.
And, or, like, experience something. So their neighbor was Sandy. And Sandy also, like, just to, like, the chef's kiss of this argument is that she also worked for the real estate agency that the Snedekers used to find this house.
Yeah.
And she was like, as someone who worked for the company they used to find this house, they would have been told this was a funeral home. Like,
I lived there
and there was nothing going on.
What if, like, Al was told, but he just, like, didn't say it, you know what I mean? And then he was like, I didn't know.
Maybe,
and she was like, so he didn't upset anybody in the family or something? I don't know.
That's a great argument. I don't know.
It's like maybe one of them knew but didn't want to say it.
But so, like I said earlier, I couldn't even, like, know all the kids' names, and there was, like, a lot of, like, I don't know when the cousins moved in. I don't know, like, so there is no, allegedly, there's no solid details about the story at all, except for the fact that Stephen had cancer. That's the only thing that we can confirm,
which is such
across
a
the board
bummer. I'm like, that's such a true fact. Okay, great.
But then again, you know, there's an argument to everything. Like, it could have been like, oh, well, they were minors, so their names were changed.
Maybe it's not really
controversial. It's just like they were trying to protect their identity. So Carmen and the niece also happened to apparently love the movie The Entity,
uh-huh.
where one of the characters was, quote, attacked almost identically to their experiences.
Oh, dear.
So there's an argument that they could have just reported what they'd seen in a movie.
And who knows, like, if, not again to just, like, throw them under the bus, but who knows, like, how much could be, like, subconsciously trying to, you know, project, like, what they've seen in a movie onto what was they were experiencing. Or...
Right. I don't know, man. Also, there's a neighbor named Joan. Fucking Joan.
There's always a neighbor named Joan.
And Joan, apparently, she was on their side for a while. She was like, I've seen the family running out of the house in the middle of the night.
Oh, dear.
And, like, saying they would not go back inside. But there's another quote from Joan saying, they never seemed to be afraid. They were always laughing. So it's like, maybe the family was, you could argue again, the parents are trying to like keep their spirits up and like trying to distract the kids and make something light of it. But also like, why were they running out of the house to begin with? Joan also did say that she herself had seen a mysterious green glowing coming from their windows, and she was stung by a mysterious force when she walked into their house one time. Could have been a bee.
oh my God.
And Joan says, quote, every time I have seen Carmen on TV, so like maybe the Sally Jesse Raphael show. Anytime I've seen Carmen on TV, the story became more and more involved and got bigger.
Mm.
So even Joan's like, I believe it to an extent. Like maybe there were ghosts, but they really amped it up for TV.
Right.
Which again, you can argue like if they were doing this for medical bill money, like of course they'd want to amp it up.
And also, that's a hard thing once you're like signed up on a TV show to like. You want to tone it down when the producer are trying to get
you. Yeah, you want to deliver.
Yeah, exactly.
So when asked again why they didn't leave, Carmen said that she was afraid they would get followed. But then there's other versions of it where she was like apparently unaware that things were going on. She said that only things happened to the kids. But then it's like, well, you also said you got assaulted. So there are some inconsistencies. But also that could just be a timeline thing because she didn't know for like a year.
Yeah.
And then things started happening to her. So maybe those are just taken out of context and two different perspectives from different times. It has been said that rather than being attacked by supernatural creatures, maybe the family was coping with being abused and harassed by Stephen.
Right.
Because he allegedly admitted to being violent with his family. And even if he wasn't, he still had attitude shifts and like was writing about necrophilia and stuff, apparently.
Right. And he was very ill. Like, they were probably coping with the trauma of, like...
Right, they were probably... exactly.
Two diagnoses.
Coping with many levels of things. And so, Ray Garten, the book that he wrote was In a Dark Place. And this is also... He's not loved by the family because apparently he... Remember, he did, like, this, like, really outlandish version of the story.
Right.
And so, members of the family really don't like that book because they're like, he made us look so fucking bad. He made it seem like this was what really happened. And so therefore a lot of the stories out there about this case are muddled now. And like, nobody really knows what officially happened.
Right.
Unless you look at some of the interviews that the family did. But that being said, he also helped confirm that this was sensationalized because just hang on a second. Let me just say it. So Ray Garten, he was actually commissioned by the Warrens during their investigation to document everything so that he could write a tell-all book about it. And so a lot of people with that backing were like, oh, this must be a nonfiction book because the Warrens themselves are telling you to write this book.
Right.
But now Ray claims that the book was fiction because apparently, just like how a lot of people have said, well, their stories don't always add up. Ray himself was like, their stories didn't add up, and I was the one in the house with them talking to them, and I couldn't get straight answers from them.
Yeah, I see.
He said, quote, I found that the accounts of the individual Snedekers didn't quite mesh. They couldn't keep their stories straight. The family was going through some serious problems, and I became very frustrated. It's hard writing a nonfiction book when all the people involved are telling you different stories.
Right.
And so even Al's sister Nancy has spoken out and said that she hates Ray for some of the things that he said about the family. But then Ray, defending himself, is like, I didn't want to say those things about the family, but one, I was confused by what people were saying. And apparently, not only were the family stories inconsistent, but the Warrens told him to sensationalize the case.
Uh-oh.
Which makes people wonder about the legitimacy of the Warrens.
Yeah, then it gets into a fucking house of cards at that point.
Apparently, the Warrens, quote, arranged for an exorcism, but they never provided any evidence of this. Apparently Ed only ever referred to the priest as Father A, and if you ever ask for more information about this guy, he would get real fucking hostile.
Whoa.
He like did not want to talk about it. And apparently the local Roman Catholic Archdiocese even says that there's no officially sanctioned exorcism from this house.
That's not a good sign.
And Ed accused one of the neighbors of being, quote, paid off by the landlord to say the activity wasn't real. Even though maybe that's not true. And Sandy was like, no, I fucking live here. Nothing happened.
Yeah.
And also one very famous skeptical paranormal investigator named Joe Nickel, he even said that he had doubts and Ed allegedly threatened him.
Jesus.
And during an interview, one of the reporters realized that Ed was like being real hush-hush about like giving direct answers and said like, hey, can you answer some more questions for the sake of credibility? And Ed Warren said, I don't care about your credibility, pal.
Pal.
Pally.
You hear me, pal?
So Ray says that he went to the Warrens upset that the Snedekers' testimonies didn't match up. And I guess because the Snedekers have said like Ray made us look like trash, Ray in defense is like, whoa, the Warrens made me do this because they're the ones that commissioned me. And this is a quote from him. He said that he went to the Warrens to complain that like the Snedekers' testimonies didn't match up and he wanted to do the book justice. But Ed said to him, quote, oh, they're crazy. All the people who come to us are crazy. You think sane people would come to us? Just use what works from their testimonies and then make up the rest. Just make it up and make it scary.
Whoa, that's not a good look.
That's not a good look, especially because the Warrens are like, I'm a big fan of them.
Yeah, they're like and the this tops.
This is not a cute look.
Pal.
So the last thing I'm going to say is the current owner, her name is Susan. And Susan says, quote, most people are respectful. They stay on the road. They might take a picture, but we have had some problems with people kind of rudely coming up to the door and scaring our kids, telling them that the house is haunted.
Don't do that. Why would you do that?
And then she says, we've lived in the house for over 10 years. Our house is wonderful. This is all Hollywood foolishness.
Hollywood foolishness.
Or you could say the exorcism worked if or one existed.
Father A so, did his job.
I'm sorry that was so long, but holy shit, wow. That was a juicy one. Every step of the way, there was something to talk about. So that is the Snedeker House.
I can't believe I've not heard of this.
And you can watch their interviews on YouTube and all that. Snedeker is spelled without a C, in case you're wondering. It's S-N-E-D-E-K-E-R.
I was wondering. Wow, thank you. That was a tale.
A tale. A tall tale.
A tall tale indeed. This is the story, M, of Bible John.
I've heard of Bible John, but I don't know what the hell this is.
Well.
Is it a guy from the Bible?
No.
Okay.
I mean, John is a guy from the Bible.
Okay. But this is a dude who calls himself Bible John? Is he a priest or something that did something bad?
No. And he does not call himself Bible John either.
Oh. See, I clearly know nothing.
Yeah.
I am learning. I am on my way to understanding.
You're actually not. I think you are
I'm
on
about
your
to be.
Way
the They other... haven't shot the gun in the air yet for me to go.
Yes.
So.
You're running in the other direction.
Okay.
Actually. But
I'm still in the bathroom changing.
You're stuck. You got stuck in the bathroom. Okay. This is the story of Bible John, and it takes place in Scotland.
Where the Bible took place.
Where also the Bible took place and CK took place. Took place. So this is the late 1960s in Glasgow, and it's the second biggest city in Scotland, just surpassed by Edinburgh, the capital.
Remember that time I called it Edinburgh because I am
yes, I do.
Not that intelligent when it comes to Scotland.
Just when it comes to Scotland.
Only Scotland.
That's
but you
the
know
one Achilles heel.
You tell me anything about Canada, maybe I'll have an answer and maybe it'll be right. I'm only like 1%.
Perhaps. Ready. Okay, so let's see. We have a lot of fun things from Scotland. We have CK. We have haggis. We have the Loch Ness Monster. We have David Tennant. We have the Fringe Festival, Edinburgh Fringe Festival.
We have one of my ancestors, according to Ancestry.com.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
So now there's this case, which is no good.
Okay.
It's the bad part of Scotland, I guess.
Fingers crossed my ancestor is not Bible John.
I really hope not.
I certainly hope not. That would explain the turbulent in my personality, though.
Yeah, it would a little bit. Yeah, mm-hmm. It wouldn't explain mine, but it would explain yours. So February 22nd, 1968, an auxiliary nurse and mother named Patricia Docker, who's 25 years old, put her parents in care of her son, Sandy, who's 4 years old, while she went out dancing with her friends from a hospital to a dance called The Majestic, otherwise known as The Magic Stick.
Okay.
So Majestic, Magic Stick, close
Remember that
enough.
Time we got wooden dildos?
Magic sticks. After dancing for a few hours, Patricia suggests they hop over to another dance hall, but none of her friends want to go, so she goes by herself. And she goes to a dance hall called the Barrowland, also known as the Barras. I'm probably saying this all wrong because I'm not saying in a Scottish accent.
Say it like Shrek and you'll have it down.
No, I'm not going to. And I suggest neither of us do because
excellent,
we get enough emails. So the Barrowland Ballroom has a huge neon sign. It says Barrowland, surrounded by images of like explosions and yellow, pink, blue, green. The sign, according to their website, is believed to be the biggest of its kind in the UK.
Ah,
which,
that's fun.
Yeah, why not? So on a Thursday night, they would have these things called Grab a Granny Night.
That sounds fun.
Well, it was the idea was that if you were over 25 and single, you were a granny because you weren't married yet or you were single.
You're a spinster.
You're a spinster.
I thought it was like take your grandma to the club.
No.
That'd been fun.
It's also a little iffy in my book because I'm like, don't grab anyone, please. Like,
In my head, it was like bring your grandma to the club night. Me and Jackie Gleckman would tear it up, okay?
Miss Jacqueline Miriam Glickman would tear it up. So this was this secret, quote unquote, weekly night where people didn't use their real names. They would take off their wedding rings if they had them. And basically, if you were unhappy and over the age of 25 and married, this was kind of where you would go to hook up with a partner on the DL. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
A little creepy with the grabbing. Don't love that part. But I don't love that, like, we're grannies at age 25, but, you know, whatever. So Patricia was married to Sandy's father, who was living in Lincolnshire, I don't know, in northern England, where he was an RAF corporal, which we learned that RAF term. RAF. We were doing a Ouija board, and he kept saying RAF, and then I remembered that.
Eva said Royal Air Force or something.
Yeah, she figured it out.
She was like, do you mean Royal Air Force? And we were like, what?
And it like shot to yes. And we were like, oh, we're dumb.
Okay, Eva.
Jeez. So it's unsure. Like, they weren't divorced. But so we don't know if she was going to meet somebody or if she was just going to dance and have fun. Like, we're not sure why she was going because she was married. Right. So who knows? But it's Thursday night and it has some reputation, you know, attached to it. So maybe that's why her friends didn't go with her. She went by herself. We do know she got there because people reported seeing her in a distinct yellow dress. But unfortunately, this was the last time she was ever seen alive. So the following morning, February 23rd of 1968, Maurice Goodman of Carmichael Place was heading toward his garage around 7 or 8 a.m. when he saw in the doorway a naked body. He ran indoors, still shaking from his discovery, called police, and the corpse, which was found half frozen because it was wintertime, was Patricia.
Yikes.
So they were able to figure out that she had been strangled to death with a ligature, but there was nothing nearby, so they didn't know what it was. They also did not see a purse or a handbag. Dr. James Imrie, who's a pathologist, believed it might have been done either with a belt or her own tights, perhaps.
Gotcha.
And the way in which her body was lying, the police also believed the murder took place somewhere else, and then the body had been placed there after she had died.
Okay.
So what's more, this is just where things get really weird and wild, is she was clearly on her period when she was found, and or when she had died, and there were several sanitary napkins lying around.
Okay.
Like, scattered.
Huh.
So just... woof.
I'll remember that. I feel like that's important.
It is. Okay. Or at least it comes back. So the police lost vital time on Patricia's murder because they initially went to the magic stick, the Majestic, because that's where she had gone.
Right.
And it wasn't clear at first. It took a couple days for them to realize she had gone to the Barrowland afterwards. And so that is probably where she met her killer.
Right.
Yeah. So locals were asked questions. Divers went into the river to see if they could recover any belongings. There were like signs everywhere asking for more information, but unfortunately no justice was found for Patricia. And because she had gone by herself to the bar, there wasn't much to go on. There was no CCTV. This is the 60s. There's no DNA. Well, there is DNA, but we just didn't really get it yet. So this is all until 18 months later. In August of 1969, 32-year-old Jemima McDonald left her three children with her sister Margaret and went dancing at the Barland, wearing a black dress over a white shirt. So it was a Saturday, and Jemima regularly went to the Barland. This was like, she was a regular, basically. The following morning, Margaret became concerned when her sister was not at home to pick up her kids.
Uh-oh.
Yeah. So later on in the day, Margaret overheard some children gossiping about finding a dead body.
Oh, God.
In an abandoned tenement housing nearby. Okay. Or an abandoned tenement. Yeah.
Right.
So this must be a really hard decision. She decides to go check it out herself, having kind of like a sinking feeling. So she passes through the crowd. She sees this body, and she sees exactly what her what confirms her fears: a corpse wearing a black dress over a white shirt. That is her sister,
oof,
Jemima. So when the police come to investigate, they noticed a few similarities between Patricia's murder 18 months earlier. Both mothers had been at the Barland. Both had been strangled, and even though Jemima was not found naked, her handbag was also gone, and both were on their period. She was also on her period. So once again, Jemima was found with sanitary napkins kind of around her body. So police again questioned locals and interviewed people who were at the Barlands that night. Didn't get much information. The only thing they could gather is that she had been spotted on the dance floor with a man in a blue suit. He was described as 6 foot tall, thin, with short hair, short fair red hair, and was aged like late 20s, early 30s. And then people said at the end of the night they left together. So very generic description of a man.
Not much to go off of.
Yeah. Especially because in Scotland it's much more common to have red hair. It's not like a wild, wildly ridiculous, you know. Not that it's wildly ridiculous here either. But it's
more
just,
common for
it's
sure.
It's definitely, I would say, more common. Yeah. So Jemima's siblings tried to offer a cash reward for any information, but nothing, just dead end. Then, for the first time in the history of Scottish murder investigations, police released a sketch to the media. And apparently, this was not a common... The Crime Junkie covered the story, and according to them, at least, it wasn't a common thing because law enforcement was worried it would lead to legal troubles if they did catch the person and then had, like, a sketch, and if that would hinder their proceedings because maybe
like if they got the wrong guy or something,
like I think it was maybe that the defense could use it as saying like, well, what, you're gonna like go off a drawing and that's how you're gonna identify it. So I don't know if that's what it was, but it seemed like it definitely was not a thing they'd ever done before. It was not commonly,
but this was like one of the times where they actually used
this. Is the first time ever.
Oh wow.
Yeah. So first time in history of Scottish murder investigation, police released a sketch to the media. They had a local portrait artist named George Lennox Patterson paint a portrait based on the collected testimonies. And again, he was 6 foot tall, thin, with fair red hair, and was aged in his late 20s to early 30s. So just kind of a generic dude. So while this investigation was going on Wednesday, October 30th, 1968, which was about 2 months after Jemima's murder, 29-year-old Helen Puttick and her sister Jean went out for a dance at the Barland. Helen's husband was not super amped that she was going, but Helen was like, I'm just going to go dance. Like, it's all good. No worries. And the two of them went out. So they started off at the Trader's Tavern on Kent Street, then arrived at the Barland just after 10 p.m. So at the Barland, Jean and Helen were seen dancing with two separate men, both named John. And again, it's iffy because people would go there and change their name. Because they didn't want to get recognized, so...
Of course everyone would pick fucking John too.
Exactly. Yeah. So it's not clear if their names were John or if, like,
they were just John.
Friends and they were like, oh, let's go call ourselves John.
Right.
So it's that makes it even more complicated. So John J. was dancing with Jean and John H. was dancing with Helen, which that's interesting that it's John J. with Jean.
Huh.
Yeah, H. with Helen. Didn't even realize that until just now. So John J. was apparently a builder from an area called Castle Milk, but John H. never revealed where he lived or in town he lived. So approaching midnight, different sources say either Jean or Helen's money got stuck in a cigarette machine, and when they were trying to get some Embassy Blues cigs.
Okay.
But either way, John H. begins arguing with the manager. He gets really worked up, really upset, and he calls the dance hall, quote, a den of iniquity.
Oh.
Ooh, those are fighting words, I think.
Those are strong words.
So after this, John J. is like, peace, I'm leaving. Y'all can get out, figure your own way home. So right. John J. leaves, and John H. says, why don't I take you, Gene and Helen, home in a taxi? Bad news.
Uh-oh.
So weirdly enough, we have a photo of this too, but Helen's flat is first on the route. Like, her flat comes first. But he dropped off Gene first.
Right.
So it was almost like they went farther to drop off Gene. Like, and then, yeah. Like,
they didn't do them in the right order.
Right. Just weird. So Gene is dropped off before the taxi continues on to Helen's flat. The taxi driver says he drops Helen off around 12:30. And after dropping her off and driving momentarily, John gets out of the taxi, is what the taxi driver says.
Okay.
So they dropped her off, and then he says, we drove for a bit, for a few moments, and then he got out of the car.
So, like, he didn't even really need to go anywhere. It's like he just
seems
wanted to,
like, he probably
wanted to know where she lived.
Followed her out of the taxi. Like, once they dropped her off, he's like, good night, and then, like, drove a block and was like, let me out, if that makes sense.
I thought in my head it was like he just wanted to, like, drive her to her place so he knew where she lived so he could come back later and do something. Mm-mm. But no, it's instant.
Yeah, that's why I think he dropped off Gene first, because he was like, I have plans.
Yes, I'll be busy tonight.
One. Yes. So the following morning, a body is found by a neighbor walking his dog. And later that day, when George goes to the police to report Helen missing, Detective Superintendent Joe Beattie took him aside, asked what Helen was wearing that night. And when George described her outfit, Joe said, I'm sorry, son, your wife's been murdered. And it's just, like, really sad, because George was like, I don't know if I feel comfortable with you going out alone with your friend.
That's awful.
Yeah.
Like, imagine the guilt.
Yeah.
If he was already hesitant, and now it's like,
well, yes, exactly. It just didn't end well, and he had a feeling about it. Yeah. So although Joe Beattie wasn't originally convinced that the cases were linked, there were, like, a lot of weird similarities between the cases of Helen, Patricia, and Jemima's murders. First of all three had been at the same place the night of the murder. Secondly, all were found relatively close to their homes. And then thirdly, there was this MO of they were all strangled, and they believe Jemima was also strangled by her own tights. Fourthly,
oh my God.
Although Helen was fully clothed, her handbag was also missing. So that was another part of the MO. And fifthly, Helen was also menstruating when
Weird.
They found her. Right? It's not just the strangest, like,
coincidence.
Yeah. Or, like,
I mean, how would he have known
exactly?
That?
Exactly. Weird, right? It's not like you run around, like, telling people you just met. I mean, I do, but, you know, I'm not necessarily.
Also, like, it's not like you can really find a way to, like, weave that into your conversation and get a direct answer from someone. Like, he couldn't have directed that information out of
her. It's just a weird way. And especially in the 60s, I don't think it was as, like, commonly spoken about as it is nowadays.
No, like, women didn't even pee or fart or anything.
Right.
You know, God forbid.
God forbid.
A period. that's lore.
Oh, Lord.
No.
Ooh, shivers. What was my name again? Surfer, Red Surfer.
Wow, the Red Surfer's reporting on
that's me.
Quite a tidal wave.
So, again, Helen was also menstruating. So, although the murderer had strewn sanitary napkins about with the others, he had tucked one under Helen's armpits.
Huh.
Isn't that strange? I don't know what that means. I mean, it probably means nothing. Maybe
like he was like, damn, you're sweaty. Like, let me just throw something
just, like,
in there.
You're a little moist. I don't know.
Should I start doing that with you when you get sweaty now?
Maybe.
Just, like,
that actually might
throw a pad under your
problems.
Armpit? A pit pad. So, question. Never mind. They were strangled. I was going to say, maybe if it was, like, a really bloody death, then, like, it was just, like, blood on a different part of her body placed there. But
no.
I'm trying to think of, like, because it's so bananas.
Yeah, and they all had, like, pads with them, or like sanitary napkins with them.
So weird. Okay.
Yeah, it's really weird. It's really weird. So there was a difference, though, between the bodies of Patricia, Jemima, and Helen, and that is that the murderer had left a bite mark on Helen's body.
Ooh. So it, arguably, if this is the same person, he's getting more and more intense.
Yes, because also he left a semen stain on her clothing.
Oh.
Yeah. So it's just bad. It's just getting worse, like so you said.
So were they all sexually assaulted?
I don't think the first two were...
Just the last
I don't one. Even know if they checked or like if in the
they just
I
saw semen know. On her
on the third woman's and the first two all they said was they were on their period, so I don't know if that was like
weird
checked or not.
Okay.
I mean, again, there was no DNA sampling, so
no answer's good. I just
yeah. So on the third victim they actually saw a semen stain, so they knew, but I don't know about the first two. So Jean, Helen's sister, was brought into questioning 3 days later, and when she went to the police office, she was shown the sketch that had been drawn after Jemima McDonald's case, the portrait artist sketch, to which she said that this man was him. Mm. She claims to have never seen the picture before, although it was a little strange because it was like all over, like plastered everywhere, the sketch, and it was even at the Barrowland, like up for people to see, so it was a little strange that she'd never seen it before,
right?
And then saw and went, that's him. But maybe she is oblivious like me and just didn't spot it. Anyway, so the things she remembered from that night were that at the Barland, John H had said he had a sister, he mentioned having a caravan in Irving, and he mentioned that he had a cousin who recently hit a hole in one in golf.
You know what? With that amount of information, you could find just about anything.
I'll just find his MySpace for you.
If there's anything Christine can do, it's drive in reverse and find anything on earth about a person if you just give her, like, the color of one of their eyes. Like,
yeah. That is one thing that I'm...
What a skill. I mean, I know most... especially, quote, girls, like, are very good with, like, internet sleuthing.
Yeah.
But... You really are like queen of it.
Oh, well, I appreciate that because I worked very hard to develop those skills. And then when I got a temp job and was literally placed at a private investigations company, I was like, this is my dream.
Your mecca.
Yeah. And
if you could tell Christine, I saw someone 3 years ago who had a blue shirt on that day. And I don't remember where in the world it was. Could have been Beijing. Could have been my own house. Oh, and Christine will be like, I'm on it.
That was Jude Law.
It's always Jude Law.
What if that was the point of the story, is that I'm always just like, I found him, and it's like always Jude Law.
Anyway, so with that much information,
that's my Achilles heel, is that everyone is Jude Law. So it's a little bit of a struggle.
It's weird that you can find anyone and yet you only find one person ever.
Yeah, so in some ways I have a little bit of a hitch there in my plans. But
well, one day when you finally get him in your car, you can show him how well you drive in reverse.
God, I can't wait.
And then you'll be like tapped out on talent,
and
suppose.
Then no one will believe me that I actually saw him, but it's okay. I'll know in my heart. So anyway, she tells them like his cousin hit a hole in golf and he has a sister, and they're like, okay, that's good news, I guess. She remembers him being around 6 foot tall, slim, with auburn or reddish hair, wearing a Reed and Taylor branded suit and having an overlapping tooth.
Huh.
So Jean has said, quote, he wasn't the Barrowland type. Many of those who used to go were kind of rough or drunk, but he was nice, very nice, polite, and well-spoken.
Sounds like a pillar of the community.
It's certainly.
A pillar of that community.
Indeed, it does. In the taxi home with her and Helen, Jean remembers his full name either being John Templeton, John Sempleston, or John Emerson. She said she can't remember, but it sounded like something similar like that. To that. So he apparently, in the taxi, continued to speak about, quote, adulterous women. And to lighten the mood, one of the sisters asked what he got up to for Hogmanay, which is New Year's celebration over there.
Huh.
To which he replied, I don't drink, I pray. Which, okay. Like, woof.
Oh, my God.
Congratulations.
Yikes. Okay.
This den of iniquity. It's all making a little more sense now. And so that is the kind of anecdote that the media latched onto and nicknamed him Bible John, because he seemed very virtuous. I didn't know how to tell you that at the beginning without explaining the whole story.
Okay, well, I was wrong.
Yeah,
it doesn't matter what I thought. It was not that.
We usually are, so it's okay.
Bible John. This whole time I've been hearing the name John, didn't even click. It was Bible John.
Yeah, that's him. There he is.
Well,
that's okay. I like when I can make it click. You know what I mean?
You know what's fun is, like, it was a really easy switch to flick on, and I just didn't even.
But I like doing it where I get to, like, be the one who watches it happen.
It's shocking how shocked I am. It's really the thing.
Oh, Bible John. They then began to talk about foster children. John said they were all right.
Great.
So-so.
They're all right.
Come see, come saw.
Which is, I guess, John's biblical opinion. And he cited Moses as an example. You know, Moses.
Is this our fourth fucking Moses?
You're right. Holy crap.
What is going on?
That's really weird.
Is there a Nelly in this?
There's not. Lose my mind. I don't think so. There's okay. A Jemima, though. That's pretty good.
A George Jemima?
There is a George. That was Helen's husband's name, remember?
Oh, shit.
Yeah.
We really need to find that Nelly.
Yeah, we got to find her. So, yeah. He mentioned Moses being found in the reeds as an infant. And so he was a foster child. So it's okay to be a foster kid.
Whatever Moses had whatever to deal Moses. With, I guess we can also deal with.
Whatever Moses thought is okay with me. Jean's testimony became the base of the investigation because she had actually interacted with this man and was in a car with him right before he murdered her sister. So she had a very close interaction with him. Whew. Someone who chose to remain anonymous thought they saw Bible John around 2 a.m. on the night of the murder getting on the bus. He had mud stains on his jacket and a red bite mark on his cheek, which
bite marks.
Shows that maybe they were fighting. So contradictory to Jean's description, the manager of the bar described Bible John as dark haired and around 5'8".
So not redheaded.
Not red and not 6 foot tall. So it's a little odd because you'd think, well, she spent more time with him. But also this guy yelled at this manager and was like, this is a den of iniquity. So they had an altercation.
Mm-hmm.
So you'd think he'd remember that one of them would remember that they saw the same guy, but right. Maybe he got them confused. Maybe he thought John H and John, do you know what I mean? Like maybe
yeah, no. The other one was
you know, the non-Bible.
I finally get it, don't worry.
I'm glad someone gets it. Either way, a new portrait was drawn but at the Glasgow School of Art based on Jean's testimony and released to the media. I'll show you a picture real quick. There it is.
Look at him.
I mean, that's like a real portrait.
That is some. That's over the mantle, the next to Captain Geo.
Not on my mantle.
Oh well.
I don't want this fella on my mantle.
You know, if he weren't a killer, he looks like a sharp man.
Just like a, yeah, exactly. And I think that's why
distinguished.
He kind of could get away with getting these women alone.
Get away with murder.
Literally, yes, correct. Yes,
I gotcha.
So on top of this, police went to golf clubs to see if they could get information about anyone's cousin who got a hole in one recently.
I thought you fucking meant that they walked up to a thing of golf clubs. Like golf clubs. Like the club.
Uh-huh.
Are what? I
said they went to some golf courses.
No, you said golf clubs.
Oh, I did? Oh, yeah. Well, then that's my bad. I meant
but
golf
then I
course.
Thought maybe in Scotland they call them clubhouses.
Well, like country club.
But when you said it, I thought they literally all tried to interview they a fucking bag of clubs.
Golf club?
And I was like, I immediately don't get it again.
No, I'm so sorry. That's my bad. They walked up to a golf
course.
They didn't walk up to it. I mean, I guess
clubhouses.
They walked up to golf courses. I meant golf course, and my dumbass just said golf
maybe
club.
Maybe you said it, and I heard club.
Who knows?
They'll play it back.
Whoever's listening knows, except we don't.
Someone else is like, I'm skipping 15 seconds. Yeah. This is so stupid.
This is really dumb. You would be correct in that assessment. So they went to these. Oh, I did write golf clubs. Just kidding. But yes, a golf club, like a country club.
I understand now.
Golf course. Mm-hmm. They asked a bunch of golf clubs what they had seen. Okay, Jesus.
That's how it came across.
Yeah, I get it. I get it. I did write golf clubs.
And then the golf club said.
I was doing this at 3 in the morning. I'm so sorry. yikes. So they went to these golf courses to see hey, did anyone get a hole in one? And do they have a cousin? So then they went to the dentist to see if anyone knew about this overlapping tooth fella. Then they went to churches to see if anyone knew Bible John, because he was clearly very religious.
Sure.
Then they literally had a group of police officers known as the Bible John Dancing Squad.
Dancing Squad.
Who went out to the Barrowland pretending to be people just wanting to have a good night out, but were actually undercover to see if they could find.
Wow, they actually did a lot with very little information. Well
that's
done.
That's what I'm thinking, right?
Well
I
done.
I was very impressed by all this. They even had an art tutor create a beautiful oil portrait.
Holy shit.
So then they said we would go for the months For months, we went to all the clubs, not the golf clubs, the clubs.
I see.
We would go to the Barland where Bible John had picked up his victims. We also went to the Majestic, the Denniston Palais. Oh, God. The Plaza. We talked to hundreds, but we never saw him. They tried. Didn't work, unfortunately. They also had tip-offs from people who had seen the sketch on TV, and that led to 5,000 different suspects, but none of them. All dead ends.
Oh, my God.
Gene then had to attend 300 police lineups, or what they call over there, identity parades, which is a lot more
so much more fun.
Exciting.
Festive.
Yes. Which sounds fucking nightmarish. She had to go to 300 of them. And oh my every God. Time thinking, maybe I'll see that man who murdered my sister. It must just be so fucking exhausting.
Jeez.
They took 50,000 statements on the case. And whenever a man who looked like he could have been Bible John was cleared, according to another article in the Scotsman, the police gave them a card that said, "I am not Bible John." Oh. So they got a special card just in case.
Someone has that and is selling it on eBay.
Can you imagine? I would have purchased that, actually. Yeah. If anyone has that, I'd put that up on my mantle.
Because it's also true if we have it.
If it is correct.
I am also not Bible John.
I deserve a card that says it. So that says so. So everybody got a special business card, basically, I guess, so you could go to the club and be like, no, you can come home with me, I promise.
I swear, this is police, this is official, this is officially licensed.
Yes, there's a wax seal on the back. It's official. However, there wasn't much evidence, there's not much information explaining what they did to even protect the women. It was more just like, here, young men, we don't want people thinking you're a murderer, so here's a card to go pick up the chicks. But gotcha. You know, at the same time, like, I don't know what the hell they were doing to actually protect women at this point, but whatever. Internationally acclaimed Dutch clairvoyant, I don't know if you know about this guy, his name is Gerard Croiset. I don't know how to pronounce
I
his
sure
last
would
name.
Love to know
Croiset. I have no idea. He helped out as a quote gesture of goodwill. According to the Daily Record, when they interviewed a former detective, he remembered Gerard Croiset having stayed in the murder investigation suite for about 2 days, then asking for a pair of Helen's underwear because he said it would help him.
I bet it would.
The mystery.
Ugh.
So creepy. He then stood on the underwear and declared. I'm sorry.
Was that a typo?
No. It's what happened.
He
really.
Stood on the underwear declared bankruptcy.
I declare bankruptcy. Okay. He stood on a pair of Helen's underwear. I'm not even making this shit up. And declared there would be another murder committed by Bible John near Sterling.
That's the ultimate prophet right there.
Yeah. Well, my next bullet is Croiset. I don't know how to pronounce his name. I'm probably doing it terribly. Is widely known as a fraud.
Is he?
Yeah. And according to Wikipedia, a Dutch parapsychologist, psychometrist, and psychic who is often asked to help police detective trace missing persons, though authenticated successes were few and compared against the failures, his success rate was ruled no better than chance. So he would just kind of like stand on people's underwear and yell, I guess.
Of course.
Which, like, I mean, I could probably do that, but okay. He said that Bible John lived in Govan, I don't know, I think that's how you say it, near Glasgow, and gave a detailed description of his house. Which also I think is really shitty if you're a fucking fraud and now you're like derailing the investigation and
right.
picking random. You're like, oh, it has shingles. It's like, what if it doesn't? And now you're just leading them to the wrong place.
Yeah. It's like an amateur getting in the way of a sting.
Yes. Of a real operation. In 1996, because of DNA advancements, the police finally had a key suspect. They thought Bible John might have been an army officer named John McGinnis, who had originally been questioned, but wasn't identified during one of the identity parades, if you will. He had died by suicide in 1980, so they couldn't like re-interview him. And unfortunately his family was hounded by the press claiming that he was Bible John, even though there was no proof of this. And so John McInnes's sister provided a DNA sample, which came back as John McGinnis' sister provided a DNA sample, which came back as an 80% match with the sample found on Helen's body. And then they exhumed the body of John McGinnis and DNA tested him, but it was not a match.
Okay.
Okay. Long story short, it wasn't this guy.
Right.
So now we're 27 years later. It's 2010. Gene passes away. And because the DNA sample found on Helen is no longer usable, the case has been cold ever since. So wow. Even with all that. So with originally 5,000 suspects, there are theories as to who it could be. There's a book called Dancing with the Devil written by a former police officer named Paul Harrison, who claims that he has evidence that whoever Bible John was, he was definitely a police officer at the time. Golden State Killer wouldn't be the fucking wow. first time. In the book, Harrison claims that Joe Beatty, the detective, had questioned the officer who was Bible John, but was then told to drop the investigation. Ugh. So there's like conspiracy shit there. Harrison states that Jean told him she was sure that Bible John was a police officer and also believes that Helen wasn't the last of Bible John's victims. So if that's true, that's creepy. Some people believe the murders were the crimes of a famous serial killer named Peter Tobin, who's a Scottish serial killer who's currently serving a life sentence for three murders he committed since 91. In May of 2007, he was found guilty of the rape and murder of a woman named Angelica Cluck. And after this, when police were searching his previous property, they found traces of the remains of two other young girls, Vicky Hamilton and Dinah McNichol. And he is linked to multiple cold cases. He does have a link to, they found a link to him in the Bible John murders and launched an operation called Operation Anagram. But they didn't find like any real proof, but the theory is supported by the following information. He did live in Glasgow until 1969. And according to the Scotsman newspaper, he met his first wife at the Barland. Yeah, when she was 17, and then he raped and tortured her before she escaped the marriage. If you see photos of him, it does look quite like the portrait of Bible John. But it's kind of generic looking dude again, so you know, he employed multiple pseudonyms in his life, including the name John Semple.
Sempleton, right?
Remember? Yeah, she said either Emerson Sempleton or Templeton. John Semple. Peter Tobin's ex-wives have gone on to say he would be very angry when they were on their periods.
But still, how did he know that?
So that's an interesting theory that I also heard, which could be that he had been sexually assaulting women. And then when he found out that any of them were on their period, maybe he was enraged and
he would
them.
Kill them.
Yeah.
So the goal wasn't always to kill them.
That's at least a theory, which...
And then he hit a triple whammy and all of them had were
well
on their
like
periods?
Maybe he was raping other women and they just didn't come forward.
Okay.
When they were on their period, he maybe snapped. That was one theory that I thought was actually very interesting, because it's like that would explain why he wouldn't know that,
right?
You know, if so
it happened after the fact that he,
yeah,
wow, okay.
So that's one theory that I thought was very interesting and very horrific. He was also known for keeping souvenirs, and he even kept one of his victims' purse, so it could be that. He was also obsessed with religion, and he bragged in jail that he had murdered 48 people, but that's also a thing people do sometimes to just
look a bit bigger.
Look cool, I guess, in jail. So although the Barland murders were in 68 and 69, and Angelica Cluck went missing in 91, at that point, Peter Tobin would have been in his 60s, and so Detective Joe Beatty is like, I don't think this man would have started murdering people in his 60s. Mm. Like, he probably had victims before that, so they could have been his victims. Does that make sense?
Yeah. No, that makes sense.
Okay. Woo! So Angelica's body was discovered a year previously under the floorboards of St. Patrick's Roman Catholic Church in Glasgow, not far from where Helen was discovered in 1969. Now, the only thing that like throws a wrench into this theory is that he got married on August 6th in Brighton in England, and stayed there until August 20th with his now ex-wife. And that was the period that the murder would have taken place. So he would have had to in Scotland and England at the same time.
So it doesn't add up.
It doesn't add up. Because Jemima was murdered on the 16th, and he apparently didn't come back until the 20th. So Bible John targeted three women in their 20s and 30s, whereas Tobin targeted teenagers, typically young women. Vicky was 15. And although Angelica was 23, she looked much younger. So people think he just, his victimology, like his type was a lot younger.
Sure.
So that doesn't really match. In the murders of Patricia, Jemima, and Helen have at this point gone unsolved, and no one has been charged as being Bible John. Detective Jackson, who was on the case, has regrets. He says he can't shake the sense that the investigation was doomed from the start. And although Detective Joe Beatty is like typically spoken about with admiration, a lot of sources say he was using the case as like a publicity, trying to get make a name for himself. Sure. And that one officer, I guess, says that he knew something and didn't say, like, he knew it was another police officer. Right. So that and, like, would and got be real shady.
Hushed off. Or-
yeah. So I don't know. The Barland is still an operating music hall. They've hosted the likes of David Bowie, U2, Snow Patrol, and a band called The Stranglers, which not very tasteful. In a 97 book called Bible John Hunt for a Killer, written by two journalists from the Scottish Sunday Mail, there is a postscript with some words from Helen Puttock's son, David, who was 28 years old when the book came out in 1997. He never really knew his mother. And has said, quote, "I wanted the murderer to go through the same pain Mum did. The killer was on the loose and I was doing nothing about it. I find that hard to cope with. He didn't exist. I can't let her memory go." And that's the story of Bible John.
Wow. I've heard of Bible John and obviously did not know any of that. But yeah. Like,
yeah.
Wow. I can't believe he never got found.
Isn't that horrifying?
I thought it was kind of like such a classic story that had an ending to it.
I know, because he has a name and you'd think like, oh, Bible right. John, he must have been identified, but no.
Right, that's why I was assumed.
That's the first kind of generic drawing of him, and then they made this one of him when Gene said he had red hair.
It's a shame he's kind of good looking.
Yeah, he is a you know,
that's I guess the Ted Bundy complex right there.
White dude, I would say. Yeah, so that's that on that on that. End of story.
Wow.
Thank you for listening to me talk.
Yeah, I think that was a pretty action-packed episode.
It was really wild, huh?
Yeah.
First year
good
shoes.
Way to start off Halloween, I suppose.
Yes, spooky season is upon us.
Spooky season.
And my next one is very spooky, too.
Oh, yeah. We still have a whole other one we're going to record right now.
Lord alive.
A whole other episode where people can be dazzled by my shoes.
Dazzled by your hat and your shoes.
That, give them the old razzle and the dazzle, you know?
I just am so glad those stupid fish flops are not involved anymore.
Oh, yeah. The second that I found these, I was like, the fish flops.
You literally said you're...
I said, Finn and Gil, you're fired.
That's right. And on that note, I will say goodbye and good luck.
You can follow us on andthatswhywedrink.com and our social medias are ATWWD... Nope. ATWWD podcast.
And?
That's?
Why?
We.
Drink.
Drink. Oh, my God.
We're in the same room.